with Ken Middlebrook in San Jose, California. He would like to discuss the early history of San Jose, as well as the early Adobe that is behind him.
Hi, my name is Ken Middlebrook. I'm the curator of collections at History San Jose. Behind me here is the Peralta Adobe, which is the oldest structure in San Jose, built in 1797. The structure was built by Manuel Gonzalez, who was a member of the De Anza expedition in 1776. This is the expedition that began in southern Arizona and moved up through the lower part of California, up into Alta California, and eventually ended up in San Francisco. The settlers here, the plan was to settle the area. And you had, at the time, you had two major well-known establishments that people are familiar with. You had Presidios and the Missions. The Presidios were controlled by the military, and the Missions were controlled by the church. And so what was needed was a civil establishment, a pueblo. And so the governor of California decided to establish the first pueblo here in San Jose. The reason for that is he had Mission Santa Clara, which was located just a few miles away from here, and he also had the Presidio in San Francisco and the Presidio in Monterey. The governor decided, based on reports that were made, that San Jose was a good location in terms of the climate, be rather conducive for growing crops and growing cattle, to help serve both the Presidios and the Missions in San Francisco, Santa Clara, and in Monterey. And so San Jose was a location. So in November of 1777, several settlers, 6 to 8 settlers, came down from San Francisco. These were all members of the De Anza Party, came down to San Jose to settle this area. Actually, the first pueblo that was settled at that time was located 2 miles north of this location where I'm standing. The settlers found within a short period of time that the local river, the Gualip River, would overflow each season. And so they were constantly being flooded out in the area. And so they petitioned the governor. It took about nearly 20 years before they got permission from the governor to relocate further upstream to the present location where we are. So in November of 1797, they moved the pueblo up here further north to what is now considered downtown San Jose. They settled the newer pueblo around a plaza called the Plaza de San Jose in the center of town. So this is the last structure of that pueblo. It was built in 1797 by Manuel Gonzalez, who was a member of that original party in 1777. Here at the Adobe, we have an interpretive sign for our visitors. On the sign shows a map of the De Anza expedition. I don't know if you can see this on your screen here, but it started basically in southern in Mexico, through southern Arizona, and all the way up basically near the coast through all the missions, and ended up in San Francisco. And it's from these settlers I mentioned. There was total about 240 members of the De Anza party total, and 68 of those members came to San Jose to settle this here, the pueblo, in November 1777. Well, when the settlers came from southern Mexico and Arizona and whatnot, there were already indigenous people here, the Ohlone Mwakwa tribe, that were already settled here in the San Francisco Bay Area. Probably difficult to see on your screen there, but we have a little map here of showing just the various different dialects that were involved here in the Bay Area. Now, the groups, there were several dozen groups in the Bay Area, and they each had their own dialect. Even though they were just a few miles from one another, you had all these separate, basically, family groups and community groups that were already settled here, and those folks were already here for 10,000 years. Now, when we think about the settlement of the Bay Area and the whole Alta California, we often forget that there were people here long before European settlement. And so that's something we have to be always mindful of. And that's one interesting about the builder of the adobe was Manuel Gonzalez, who was actually an Apache Indian. So there's some history here in terms of tying the different cultures and groups together here in San Jose. Also on the sign here, once again, probably difficult to see here due to this light, is we have a map of the original Pueblo here in about 1780. And on the right here, we actually have a census, believe it or not, from 1778, a year after the Pueblo was established. As I mentioned, there were 66 settlers that came down from San Francisco. On the census here, there's a total of 68 settlers that are shown. Why the discrepancy? Well, there were two infants that were born after the settlers arrived here in San Jose. So that's kind of a rather interesting tale. But that's something nice about this interpretive map. We can't tell everything, but it's nice something to show for the visitors who come to the Pueblo, something to get more information about the history behind this historic structure. I'm now sitting on the porch of the adobe. And so in 1797, when this building was built, along with the other structure of the Pueblo, there was, imagine just open space agricultural lands surrounding the adobe. Each settler was given so much acreage in the community, so they were responsible for farming it. And so Mr. Gonzalez had a lot of property behind the adobe going toward the Guadalupe River, which is about a quarter mile behind the building here. And so this is the area that he helped type settle with the other settlers. They had people near, once again, there was a plaza that the other adobe surrounded. And this structure was actually kind of on the north end of the community. So maybe that's one reason why the adobe had survived for so long. It's because it was actually kind of away from the direct center of the plaza. Within a few years after Mr. Gonzalez built this adobe, he passed away. And so the next owner was actually had more prominence in the community, and that was Maurice Peralta. He owned a lot of land in the East Bay. But Maurice Peralta was actually a child that traveled with the De Anza party in 1776. So Mr. Peralta and Mr. Gonzalez had an ongoing relationship. Mr. Peralta had, after he grew of age, he became a member of the military, and he had a small family. And as a commission, now after he basically retired in the late 1790s, he was given he was given the land in the East Bay. And by that time, San Jose was actually his home, because his family was part of the original Pueblo settlers in 1777 in San Jose. So once again, that long-term relationship between Mr. Peralta and Mr. Gonzalez. Well, anyway, when Mr. Gonzalez passed away, Mr. Peralta bought the adobe from the family. And so Mr. Peralta moved his family into this adobe. There's only two rooms in the adobe proper, and there's a large balcony or loft up above. And so consequently, Mr. Peralta raised his whole family here, and he raised 9 children in this structure. And as we explore this a little bit further, you'll see how small it is. Now, anyway, this is a rather unique correlation between the two families. They both traveled in the De Anza expedition. They both settled San Jose, and Mr. Peralta lived in this home. Even though he owned all this land, or was that actually given as part of his military pay, all the land in the East Bay, he still selected this site to be his home. And he actually lived in this home until he passed away in 1860. That's hard to believe. So he lived here in this building through three different government entities. He had the Spaniards in 1800. He had the Mexican rule starting about 1823, and then American rule after 1847. So it's rather interesting that Peralta lived here for that length of time. Hi, we're now in the bedroom portion of the two-room adobe. For interpretation purposes, we've elected to interpret the different eras of the adobe. You had the two significant eras. The Spanish period of this adobe was 1797 to approximately the mid-1820s. And then from 1820s to late 40s, when suddenly you now have the American rule, during that time frame was the Mexican or California period. Well, here in the bedroom, we represent here the Spanish era. Now, why the difference between the two eras? Well, during the Spanish era, the settlers here, Spain wanted all the control. They wanted all the taxes. So there was limited access to the settlers for outside goods. They were not allowed to trade with other countries. And so the settlers here in Alta California, they were really on their own. They had to rely on what they found locally to build different things, like the bedroom, the bed, the different ohlone shells were used for containers, and a chair. This is a rather unique piece. If you look closely, what is this made out of? A lot of people think that, oh, that's some sort of bone of what type of animal. Well, if you look more closely, this is actually made out of whalebone. That's a whalebone chair. Well, why would they make a whalebone chair? Well, if you couldn't buy anything or trade with other parties, they had to make do with what they had, and certainly had whale carcasses that would wash up along the coast. And so they would actually make, certainly they get the whale oil for lamps, but they would use the carcass and the bones to make other things. And in this case, they made a chair out of whalebone, which is rather interesting because, once again, the period people during the Spanish era until the 1820s, they really were on their own here in Alta California, and they had to make their own goods. Now, everything that you see in this room, except for the whalebone chair, is all reproductions. And that's something that we share with our visitors, is that what you hear is something that represents that time frame, but it's not 200 years old. And we, as museum folks, that's what we're trying to be honest with our folks, our visitors, letting them know that that's what it looks like, but it's not really, we don't know for sure. This through what you see here, all the items here are something that we put together based on careful research of different documents, diaries, just kind of understanding what people may have used at that time frame. Here we have a cradle that was made out of skins, okay? And it's supported by fur and skins from the roof. Now, we've used cables to ensure that it doesn't fall down, but that's, once again, to show the resourcefulness that the residents of the area had to use during that time frame from until 1820, when you had now the Mexican rule. So now we've moved into the family portion of the adobe. As I mentioned prior, there's only two rooms, the bedroom and this family portion. Now in this area, for interpretation purposes, we represent the Mexican or California era. So in here, once again, I previously mentioned that we have reproduction furnishings. That's what we have in here, is reproductions to represent to our visitors at that time frame. Now, When Mexico declared its independence from Spain, Mexico was not concerned as much in terms of the control of Alta California as Spain was. They were more interested in just surviving. And so they started to enable the residents of Alta California, the Bay in particular, to now trade with the ships that were coming into the bay harbor. And so as a result, you start seeing influence from different areas around the globe in the furnishings of the different folks. You have porcelain in China from the Far East. You start having furniture from Europe now being transported here around the Horn by ship. So you start having the international flavor of the furnishings in Alta California. And so this is what is represented here, and this is what we share with our visitors in terms of how history has changed, how this adobe has lived through all these changes for over 200 years. So you get a sense here of how people live at that time frame. Now, one thing that you will notice in here, there is no cooking or stove or any type of utensil, big wash basin or whatnot in this space. That's because they did their cooking outside. And there's an horno outside that we'll talk about later that will kind of explain that process. But this really is rather remarkable that we live in such a nice climate, Mediterranean type climate in the Bay Area, that is rather comfortable, a lot or throughout the year. And that was the case for centuries, because that's why the Mwakma Ohlone tribes, they were rather comfortable here for thousands of years, because they had everything that they needed: the nice climate, adequate game, adequate soil for producing agriculture. And so it's a rather nice environment to be in. So I want to explain about adobe structures, that this structure is made out of brick. I'll show you brick. This is kind of a form that they used, and what they would do, they would find adobe clay that was just naturally around the area here, and they would add straw to the clay, and they mix it, and then form it in these bricks here. These bricks were about 15 inches to 22 inches long, okay? And this structure here, this is a rather small structure that they used over around 10,000 bricks to build this small structure. So I can imagine how many bricks it would take to build a larger structure. Well, the secret about adobe is that it's all natural. Once the brick dry, they start stacking the bricks to make their walls. Okay? And when they stack the brick, they actually use additional adobe, a little different mixture, to kind of make the cement putty around to hold the bricks together. So, basically this is all mud, essentially mud. And you think that, if you have mud, that's going to eventually just dissolve. No, the second secret to adobe structures is the plaster that was applied on the outside of the adobe brick. The plaster provides that little protection from the elements, whether it's wind, rain, or even sun. But that plaster is what protects the bricks from dissolving. And so you cannot see here, you have a thin layer of about half an inch to 3/4 inch thick, a plaster that they would use with oyster shells and other items from the area to provide that protective layer. And with this, you also have various beams that you put on top of to make doorways. And so you have a beam up here that's supported underneath by the adobe, but still you wanted to have a solid structure for the adobe bricks that are going to be on top of the beam. So that's how you make a doorway. And so it's a rather ingenious, you think this is a process that's been used for centuries if not thousands of years, and people are still building adobe structures around the world. And one thing nice about adobe structures is on the interior, the temperature roughly stays the same throughout the year, which is rather nice when you have a hot day like today or a cold day in the winter times. Another interesting thing about this area that we're at right now, if you notice, the doorway looks a little wide. Well, that's tied to the preservation of this structure. After Mr. Peralta passed away in roughly 1860, the structure was used as a warehouse. The other people would use this for just storing grains or different materials. And one owner in the late 1800s was a wine owner, winery. So he had a winery business. And so he actually had to widen this particular door to accommodate wine barrels that came rolling back and through from the front door to the back. At that time it was just a storeroom, but what was the bedroom. So the reason why this doorway is wider is for those wine barrels. Now, rather interesting, it's like, it's a house converted to a warehouse. Because it was a warehouse, that's why this structure survived for over 200 years, because this was an outer building. And so the local owners who subsequently bought the property, they used this building, once again, because it's nice and cool, due to the adobe construction, that it was a nice warehouse or storeroom that they used for years. And so in the mid 20th century, in the 1950s, the local historians still knew that this structure was here, even though it was surrounded by newer construction at that time in the 1950s. The historians knew that, hey, there's an original adobe in downtown San Jose hidden, but it's still there. And so through their efforts in the 1960s, that they led toward the acquisition of the property by the city of San Jose. And this structure actually became historic landmark number one for the city of San Jose, which is rather appropriate because it's the oldest structure in San Jose. And so as part of the bicentennial preparations in the 1970s, the city of San Jose paid for a complete restoration of this structure. Because even though it was preserved, that the owners had kept it relatively intact, there were some things that had to be upgraded, like a new roof had to be placed in. You had concerns about earthquake safety, so they ended up actually putting steel posts at each of the four corners to ensure that the structure would never collapse on itself. Then, going back to adobe and plaster, one of the keys for maintaining your adobe structure is replacement or rehabilitation of the plaster. That's something that's an ongoing maintenance that you have to do, because plaster, like anything else, will eventually degrade. But as long as you replace the plaster, you don't have to replace the adobe structure or the adobe bricks that are inside the plaster. Hi, I'm outside the adobe here. I mentioned on the inside in the family room, there's no cooking area. That's because they did the cooking outside with an orno like this. This is a replica orno that was made, once again, for interpretation purposes with our visitors. The orno enabled folks to, it's just basically a simple oven that they would put wood around on the inside, light that on fire, heat up the entire oven, and then they would cook products inside there. And so because of the temperate climate, they did their cooking outside, and for the most part, they do all their activity outside, and they would only go inside the adobe during periods of inclement weather or when they wanted to sleep. Speaking of sleeping, I mentioned that there were several children that the Peraltas raised. Well, the children slept upstairs, and they would have to climb a steep ladder, up to the loft. And so that was kind of a rite of tradition that children would be old enough, they would be moved out of the parents' bedroom, out of the cradle area, and if they could go up the stairs, they would sleep up there. A little bit more about what History San Jose is and who I am as an individual. Well, I mentioned that the Prato Adobe was restored by the city of San Jose and for the bicentennial celebration in 1976. Well, this was a city park for a number of years and became a part of the park system for the city of San Jose, of which included the Fountain House, which is directly across the street, and also a 14-acre park south of downtown called History Park. Well, the city of San Jose operated these as a member of their parks under the Park Department, and in the mid-1990s, there were some problems about funding and how to move forward. So at that time in the mid-1990s, that the city of San Jose decided to privatize the management and operation of all the historical sites, which includes the adobe structure that I'm sitting in right now. So in 1997, a nonprofit, History San Jose, was formed to manage these assets for the city of San Jose. That enabled the city of San Jose to not have to pay the retirement benefits, the medical benefits for the employees working at the museum. Now, those folks who worked at the museum at the time under the Park Department, they were able to move to other departments within the city of San Jose. But moving forward, the city of San Jose did not want to pay for the high costs of employment in terms of that. And the idea was that with a nonprofit will be able to open up newer avenues for fundraising in terms of upkeep of not only the adobe, but the 14 acres, which has 32 buildings on it, are all historic buildings themselves. So imagine that, you have all these historic buildings. You know, if you own your own house, imagine having 33 of them. Now, it's rather expensive when you consider all the upkeep they have to do for these structures. And so we're constantly looking for different funding sources to help with historical grants or whatnot to be able to pay for these structures. And so that's how History San Jose was formed and what our relationship is with the city. My office is actually located directly across street from the 14-acre park. And outside my office, we have about 45,000 square feet of warehouse space where we have basically anything under the sun other than adobes in our storage. We have automobiles, we have old computers, we have old typewriters, we have documents. One set of documents that we have in our collection is what we call the Pueblo Papers. These Pueblo Papers were documents that were basically the communications between Alta California and either Spain or Mexico City, the communications that went back and forth. And so we have nearly 5,000 of those items, artifacts within our own collection. And so we have a rather extensive regional subset of our history within our holdings, their history park here at the Adobe and at the collection center where I work. So I'm now the curator of collections of History of San Jose. I have to tell you, I love my job. It's just rather fortunate. But it's actually my second career. I worked in high tech in the semiconductor world for 25 years. And there I was a contracts manager working for some of the defense contractors and electronic industries. Yeah, I also had a master's degree that I got from St. Mary's to supplement my bachelor's degree of business from San Jose State. Well, after working in high tech and surviving through various layoffs and very stressful, I got laid off for one last time, and my wife, of all people, said, "Why don't you follow your passion, which is museums?" And so that's what I did after my layoff. I took that as an opportunity that, hey, I can change my life and call it a midlife crisis, whatnot. But that's what I did. I made the big leap to museum studies. I knew the people working at History San Jose through my affiliation through different groups. And so I was familiar with who they were. And so I basically asked them, how do I get into the museum world? And they said, the first thing you want to do is get your master's degree in museum studies. I already had a master's degree, so that meant going back for another second master's degree. Now, maybe I'm educated beyond my intelligence, but that's what I have. And so it turned out that my predecessor at Here's History, Sensei, she had cancer. And so I started volunteering at History Sensei, which is, I think, important for anybody entering into the field, is you want to volunteer. That's basically what you're doing there, is you're building up your resume. Because you want to kind of show potential owners, whether it's a museum, a business, that you're capable of doing different things and capable of taking responsibilities. And so I volunteered for over a year and a half at History of San Jose, and then an opportunity came where they offered me a part-time job. And so I took the part-time job to help, you know, do the things that I was currently doing, and that led to the predecessor, the curator that was my before me. She unfortunately passed away eventually of her illness. And so at that time, because I was a known entity with the director of the museum, she came to me and said, well, if you're interested in becoming the full-time curator, you're welcome to do that under one condition, that you finish your master's degree. And subsequently, I did that at JFK University. And it's the best thing I've ever done. It's that it's expanded my horizon in terms of meeting fantastic people, getting to know people in the community, getting interviewed by different media outlets, and just the stress level that I suffered through the electronic industry is just not there. Yes, you did have stressful incidents in when you're working at a museum. Well, for any organization, you're gonna have stressful incidents, but I don't have the depth of stress that I had when I worked for the electronic industries. And it's just an enjoyable field, but it's rather difficult, and by no means are you going to get rich.